Coming up, we are going to take a first look at updates to remote desktop services, now with deeper cloud integration from endpoints and authentication through to back-end infrastructure. We're going to show you new service architecture options that will help improve security and authentication. We're going to show you simplified setup and management that's going to leverage app services, and a very transformative app delivery and user experiences. And I'm joined by Scott Manchester from the RDS team. Scott, welcome to Microsoft Mechanics Live.
Thanks for having me back, Simon. Thanks to all of you for showing up. We got standing room only out here.
It's nice to get a round of applause.
Yeah.
So Scott, last time you were on the show, you showed us some pretty awesome graphics improvements. What have you and the team been working on since then and since doing all that scale work that you did as well?
Yeah, Simon, we have not been sitting back on our heels here. We've been very busy since the last time we were out here. We've continued our focus on cloud optimizations. We've expanded our app and desktop delivery options, and we've hardened our security posture.
And of course, security is one of the main reasons that people are using remote desktop services.
Yeah, that's right. And now it gets even better with our latest generation of remote desktop services. We can now take advantage of modern authentication with Azure Active Directory integration. And this gives you advantages like conditional access policies, multi-factor authentication, and integration with other SaaS apps like Office or Workday.
And obviously, if anybody's using Office 365, they already have Azure Active Directory set up.
Yeah, that's right. If you've already got an Active Directory set up, you can leverage that with this new RDS modern infrastructure. And also, we can take inputs from the intelligent security graph. So if, let's say you're connecting up to a deployment and you have a non-enrolled device, we can dynamically assign conditional access policies. So now let me tell you about how the modern infrastructure changes things. If we take a look at a traditional RDS infrastructure roles, each server role would be joined to the domain. And these components would need to be on the same network as your application and desktop host, your session hosts and VDI instances. And here, because your RD web and RD gateway role are both domain joined and public facing, they're vulnerable to attack. Now with the modern infrastructure roles, we can isolate the infrastructure components from the application and desktop hosts. And the internet-facing roles like RD Web and RD Gateway are no longer joined to the domain. And because of this, we can now support multi-tenant deployments. And notice also in my infrastructure, there's no more RD VH role. We brought the VDI management capabilities directly into our connection broker. But we've also added a new role. You'll notice there's a diagnostic role. We can now leverage this new diagnostic role to troubleshoot end-to-end connectivity problems. And finally, the application and desktop hosts no longer require inbound ports. So we now establish an outbound port on port 443 to maintain that connectivity between the clients and the endpoints.
And if I'm hearing all of that right, that actually means that those architectural changes are going to give you a ton more capabilities for running this infrastructure outside of your own on-premises network.
Yeah, that's right. Hosters are really going to love this because now I can support these multi-tenant deployments, and they're really going to love it when I can deploy this up into Azure. Let's talk about the clients.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the clients first. I'll tell you guys about all the Azure value prop. So I mentioned in the intro that we're continuing to invest in our remote desktop clients. Mm-hmm. So we're adding new capabilities and functionality to all of our clients, iOS, Android, Mac, and Windows. We're also introducing our new HTML5 client. Now, this HTML5 client will work with your traditional RDS 2016 roles, but it'll also work with our new RDMI, or Remote Desktop Modern Infrastructure roles. It's actually built in. We also support the new Windows 10S edition. Now, while we're talking about the clients, I also want to mention that we're going to be bringing in this Azure Active Directory integration to all of these clients as well, and we'll show you a demo of that in a minute.
OK, that's gone a little bit out. So, obviously, we've got all of these kind of amazing things that we've been working on with cloud scale. Can you show us a little bit around what it is that you've actually been building here? It sounds great.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's take a look at that. So first off, let me show you a security demo. So what I have set up here is I have a remote desktop client that's been enlightened with our Azure Active Directory support. So I'm right at the point in time where this would be a one-time process a user would go through to add the subscription to this client. So I've got applications and desktops that my IT admin have set up, and I'm about ready to add this user to that deployment. So I've put in the URL. I'm going to hit subscribe here. Now, just like in a normal deployment, I can provide my username and password, so I'll just provide that. right. I keep forgetting that. I'm so glad that I have people in the audience that know the URL I'm going to here. All right. So username and password are provided here. But because my IT admin was savvy, they not only set up single-factor authentication, but they also set up multi-factor authentication. Should I click the button here? So I had a choice of what multi-factor auth I wanted to use, and I chose to use my phone. So show you, this is real. My phone's ringing. I'm going to answer. I'll put this on speaker.
Thank you for using the Microsoft sign-in verification system. Please press the pound key to finish your verification.
So with that, I provided two-factor authentication. And you'll see now that it'll populate the list of applications that I have here. So very cool. There it is. Multi-factor authentication to get access to my remote desktop deployment. Think of the possibilities now, how you can further secure your remote desktop environments by using these capabilities. So lots of new innovation there.
That's pretty cool. But what was actually happening behind the scenes there? What was going on as all of that authentication was going on? Because maybe these folks don't really know that much about Azure AD.
Yeah, let's walk through that process a little bit so you guys understand how this actually works. So in our deployment here in this example, it's in steady state. I've deployed the infrastructure up into Azure, and my application and desktop host can live in a separate network. And you can see that we also have set up our AAD so we can support that secure authentication. And in steady state, all of my application and desktop hosts maintain an active connection into the deployment, so we can ascertain the resource availability. So let's go through a typical connection sequence. So let's say a user on our client wants to get access to a line of business application that my IT admin has set up for me. So before the user gets access to that list of apps, you saw that process that I must provide my credentials. Once I've established my ADAL authentication, I can provide that token to my RD web client. I get the list of applications. From there, the user can then select the specific application that they want to launch. Once they've selected the application they want to launch, so here you can see in the diagram that they go through the ADAL auth, they get that list of apps, they click the one that they want to execute. We'll then take that ADAL token that we get and we'll present it into the infrastructure. We'll validate that it's active. And then we'll convert that token to a certificate. And this is the critical component, because this allows me to have single sign-on experience all the way into my application and desktop hosts. And once I've provided that connectivity, that inbound connection then will be routed through the gateway to my endpoint, and now the user can launch the application. So through simple setup on your part, you can now support a single sign-on experience plus all the value add of AAD and the capabilities you have to enable multi-factor authentication there or other conditional access policies.
So in this configuration, are the application and desktop host domain joined?
Yeah, so nothing really changes in the way you set up your session host servers and your VDI instances. They're still domain joined as they were before, but now you don't have to have that open inbound port on port 3389. And I'm sure your CTOs will be glad that you don't have to go beg to open that firewall port anymore. We use that outbound 443 connection now to enable that communication to flow.
So that's the security side of things that we said we were going to cover covered. What about the modern infrastructure that you've built on Azure?
Yeah, so back to that. So we mentioned that hosters are really going to love this because you have the ability now to deploy all of these infrastructure roles into Azure as PaaS roles. So I actually have that on my desktop here, if we can bring that up. So this is actually my personal subscription into Azure. And what I have pinned to the dashboard here is a resource group, which is our new remote desktop modern infrastructure. So let me drill into this a little bit. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to sort by type because I want you to notice something here. I want you to notice what's here, but also what's not here. So this is a full remote desktop modern infrastructure deployment into Azure, and there's not a single VM in it. Everything here is running as Azure PaaS. So if I go down the list, let's take a look at what we have. So here's our new diagnostics role. Here's the broker, the gateway, the RD web, all of them running as an Azure app service. I've got the policies around those app services. I've got a key vault, and this is where I store all the certificates for my deployment. And then I've got a SQL database that's running as an Azure PaaS service. And as you know, the database maintains the state of my deployment, which users are assigned to which applications, and also what the current state, like who's running on which VM. Now, the cool thing is that all of these infrastructure roles are now stateless. And this gives me the ability now to have that scalability we talked about, right? So I want to drill in and show you an example of how scalability works now that these things are running as PaaS roles. So I'm going to drill into our gateway.
So I'm guessing that this is going to let you automatically expand and contract maybe the size of your deployment?
You're stealing my thunder, Simon. That's exactly right. So let's drill into this here. And I'm going to scroll down here into this list. And I'm going to find the scale out policies here. So now that this is deployed as a PaaS service in Azure, I can set some very simple policies that allow this thing to scale in and scale out to conserve my cost, because I don't want to stand up the size of the infrastructure I need for the maximum time. I want this thing to dynamically adjust as my workloads go up and down. Some of you guys have probably written some really complex PowerShell scripts and have done some complex things to try to support this. I'm going to make this so easy for you guys. You guys are going to have to go find something else to do in that time that you were spending doing that in the past. So I set two policies here. So the first policy here is basically stating when my gateway role exceeds 70% CPU utilization, add another instance. And then after that stabilizes and the workloads expand across that, if that ever goes beyond 70%, install another one. And I've set a min and max parameters on this, so minimum is one instance and max is five, but I could change those things as well. So very simply, I've just set these simple parameters, and when my gateway gets burdened with a bunch of users logging in, it just simply adds another instance. Now what I've done also is I've set the scale in policy. So that was my scale out. My scale in policy says, however many instances I have of that app service running, when the average workload across all of them gets below 30%, remove one. And then it stabilizes, and if it's still below 30, you could remove another. So what happens now, 2 in the morning, everybody's done working, the system will stabilize down to a single instance of these roles. Monday morning, 9 o'clock, everybody's logging in. As that login storm happens, we simply just install more instances of the gateway and the broker and web role, and then as that stabilizes, it just shrinks back down. And this gives you the most optimal cost model now for your deployment. And this becomes so simple for you now to manage and maintain. You set these parameters once, and you're done. The system will simply take care of itself. And because they're all running as Azure PaaS services, you're not patching these VMs anymore either. It just simply just runs on its own from this point forward.
It's pretty incredible that you've taken all of the cool stuff that we can do in the cloud about removing the patching, making things much easier and simpler to run and scale, all by moving from IaaS instances over to PaaS instances. That's the kind of thing that's really going to change the way that people are able to use remote desktop services.
That's right. That really leverages the power of the cloud and the power of the web as well. So with that, maybe this would be a good time to show one of the new innovations we've done as well. So I'd mentioned that we've been making investments in the remote desktop clients. What I'd like to show you now is our new HTML5 experience. So what I have here is it could be any HTML5 browser running on any device. And I'm accessing a remote desktop 2016 deployment that I have in my Azure service. So I've installed this client. Now, if you've already got a 2016 deployment, there was a patch that was released a number of months ago to your gateway that enables this capability. And we'll provide these bits that allow you now to host an HTML5 client experience in your deployment. We'll make those available to you early next year. So I've got this set up now. I've got a handful of apps that I've made available through this feed. And I could have also enabled, if this was an RDMI deployment, our next generation, I could have enabled multi-factor authentication through this HTML5 client as well. So here's all the apps that I've made available, even a full desktop. But I want to show you a little bit of what the experience is. I just navigate around. So I've even got things like being able to pin the apps to the sides. It works pretty well. Now, you can see we're running in a pretty low resolution here, and I'm taking up a lot of the Chrome, or a lot of the workspace with the Chrome of the desktop and such. So let me do this. Let me go into full screen mode. And I can even hide this little app bar here by just hitting this little up arrow. And now I get the full desktop experience running inside of a browser. And if you just walked up to this machine, you'd probably be hard-pressed to even know that this is actually just running in a browser. Now imagine the scenarios where this could be useful for you. Imagine if you had a kiosk type of situation, and you had a lot of workers rotating through accessing that kiosk. They can simply log into the browser here, provide their credentials, and then have this great remoting experience. Another scenario Simon and I were talking about, Simon and I went on a vacation somewhere and I forgot my laptop, I could just grab his machine, open up his browser, and get access to a line of business app. So if there was some work I needed to get done, log into the browser, get that work done real quick, and in my session. So very cool. And in terms of deployment, obviously there's no work on your side now. If you have seasonal workers, people that you spend a lot of time getting them all set up, only to have them leave a couple months later, really great solution there for seasonal workers, since there's really no setup, no touch points for you guys. Thank you. Definitely some people in the room that have worked through that before, huh?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's a big thing for anybody that's running RDS. It is a very impactful thing. You have made some amazing changes there. They're phenomenal. An HTML5 client just really works well. I think we're about done, and we need to start thinking about wrapping up, and you and I need to go and plan that vacation.
That's right.
Is there anything that these folks need to know so that they can maybe get involved and learn a little bit more?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm sure you guys are excited to get your hands on this. I can tell by the audience here, there's a lot of interest in this space. So we want to make this available to you guys as soon as possible. We want you guys to start building out your own dev environments, start experimenting with this and playing with this, and giving us feedback. So we're going to make all of these, both the remote desktop modern infrastructure roles and the HTML5 client, available through the Windows Insider program for business. So if you guys haven't already signed up for the WIP or Windows Insider for Business program, please do that. We'll make these things available. Sometime early next year, we'll make all of this accessible to you guys.
Cool. OK. That is about all we have time for on Microsoft Mechanics Live. Thank you all very much for being in here in person. And thank you very much for watching. We will see you next time.
Thanks, Simon. We'll be right back.